I went live really fast this time. Google is stepping it up, I think. Hey guys, it's Samantha Studebaker Carl here with you for the Saturday Morning Mastermind. Welcome, welcome, welcome. We're glad to have you. And you know, this is the first discussion of our new book. We just started the book, "Change Your Thoughts, Change Your Life" by Wayne Dyer, and it's about living the wisdom of the Tao. And so we're all really excited to discuss this book. But before we get started, I want to just tell everybody to go ahead and meet us over at SaturdayMorningMastermind.com. That is the live broadcast page on our website where you can kind of participate in the discussion. And just as kind of a heads up on the discussion part, if you want to add a comment, you just have to scroll all the way down to the bottom of the page to the bottom of the comments and add your comment there, and then the page will refresh and the video should start right back up again. I'm still in the process of searching for a better commenting system that will work along with our live broadcast. So if anybody comes across something that works on a blog and a website, updates instantly, and doesn't affect the video, then let me know, because I'm still searching. So, but with that, I'm going to go ahead and give everybody a chance to introduce themselves. And while they're doing that, you as a viewer can add a comment on the page and just let us know that you're out there and you're hanging out with us. So who wants to jump out first?
I'll jump out and just say hello to everybody. It's great to be back and looking forward to the discussion.
Well, hi everyone, this is Julia and I am so excited to be here. And I got to read the preface of the book, but I continue to the first verse. So this is the beginning of the book. I had to force myself to stop reading it, but I can see that I'm going to get a lot out of this book, and I'm so happy to be able to share my experiences and hear everyone else's throughout. So I'm looking forward to what the future holds in regards to this book. So it's nice to see everyone again. I hope you guys had a wonderful Thanksgiving and 2 weeks off, and I'll leave it on to the next person.
Good morning. This is Catherine Clement in Boulder, Colorado. And I'm like you, Julia. I started reading, you know, I read the preface and then I read the first one. And then I was like, on to the next one. I'm like, no, wait. So I'm looking forward to this. And just one of the things that appeals to me already is just the simplicity of it, which is something that I think, you know, as a mastermind, we always try to keep it really simple and basic here. So I think it's going to fit in really well with our group. And Sam, I'm just so thankful for you for all the work you do on that website. And I know the chat's a little bit convoluted right now, but you know, it's working and we'll find a little bit better one. And I'm just so thankful to be together with all of you again.
I'll jump out. I'm Dan Sisick, and I haven't gotten the book yet. I did order it through the site, so through Powell's. So on the link to help our community. So nice little plug there for the community to help, you know, with that. Just like you guys giving rave reviews and you're just on the preface. So I'm looking forward to getting into it. And I've heard of Wayne Dyer, but I've not really read any of his books. So this is going to be a new experience for me.
Good morning. Can you hear me? My computer is being a little wonky. Hopefully it works through the whole thing. Good morning. I'm happy to be here. Good to see you all again. It felt like we were gone for a month. But yeah, I feel the same way as you, Julia and Catherine. I read the first chapter and I wanted to keep going, but maybe I'll keep going and go back again through each chapter as we go. So yeah, it's a great book. I love Wayne Dyer. I've read a couple of his books and I've followed him for years, and I never read this book, so I'm excited to delve into this one with y'all. Okay.
Awesome. I'm so glad to have you guys here, and I'm looking forward to reading this book as well. Welcome, Rhonda, and let's see who else is hanging out with us. Chava, I hope that I'm pronouncing your name right. I'm not sure. Welcome, Karen, and is Donna with us? Did she show up? I'm not sure. Let's see, who else said they were going to come? Hiron? And okay, that's it for right now, but go ahead and guys, just comment on the page, let us know that you're hanging out with us, and let's go ahead and get talking about this book. And so what I really wanted to discuss today is how everybody wants to go about studying this book, because it's, you know, Wayne Dyer, when he put this book together, he spent a year going through multiple versions of the Tao. He said that he picked out, I think he said 10 different versions, 5 older ones and 5 newer ones. And then he would spend, you know, each week or every 4 days or something like that, he would go through a new verse and he would meditate on it and he would study it and he would think about it and how he would apply it in his life. And then he would write what he thought. And, I thought that that was really interesting, because what we can do also is we can share what our interpretation is and then look at what his interpretation is and then kind of bring everybody's interpretations together and then gain a lot more insight from that. So I think that that's my kind of thought process. What do you guys think about this so far, as far as what do you think? How do you think we should go about studying this to get everybody the opportunity to gain the most insight from it?
Well, my first question, Samantha, is how long do you want us to, is there a time span for us to finish reading this book?
Well, and the great thing is that we're not limited. We can spend as much or as little time on this book as we want to. And mm-hmm. I think that if we're really going to get the most out of it, I mean, Wayne spent a year on it, you know, and it does have, it's 81 verses. I mean, we could easily spend a year and a half on this book, if not more. So I guess it's just really, you know, everybody has to kind of share their own opinion as mm-hmm. to what they think. I mean, we could get, you know, 10 chapters into it and be like, okay, I'm bored with this, or it seems like it's saying the same thing over and over or whatever. I mean, I have no idea, because I've never read the Tao. And I've never read this book before. I've read a lot of other stuff from Wayne Dyer. And so I don't know. What do you guys think?
No. Okay, because the verses are very small. They run about 2 or 3 pages. And I was thinking maybe we can go through each week, maybe 4 verses, and everyone just give their input of the verses. That's what I was thinking.
I think that we'll have to, you know, sort of play it by ear as we go along, but these verses, although they're very short, they obviously have much depth to them, or there wouldn't be all of these interpretations and different, you know, I think it's great. I think we should all absolutely share what our interpretation of the each one is. I don't know that we need to do one per week, but I don't know that more than 2 per week. I mean, I think that they're going to bring up more conversation than what we actually, I think they have enough depth that they will carry more conversation than what we think. But I agree with you, Julia. That was my first thought. Oh my gosh, they're so short. And then as I reread it and I started, you know, seeing how it was coming into me, I'm like, oh no, these are going to be, it's going to be like in the last book where we thought, oh, this chapter, there's nothing in this chapter. And then we wound up spending like 2 weeks on it or something, remember?
Yeah. As with Samantha, it's my first time reading one of, you know, Mr. Dwayne Wire's books. And I was reading and I realized that this, you know, even if it's one verse, I'm going to have to spend some time on this, because it was a little bit hard for me to understand. But the good thing about the book is at the end, he simplifies what he's trying to say in a way that I really understood. But I felt that okay, I'm obviously going to be reading more books like this, and I have to, I personally will need more time to understand. And that's why I'm really happy that, you know, I'm in a group like this, because, you know, I'm not reading it by myself. Everyone can, you know, help each other. And I would have more understanding of what the DIO is, if I'm saying that correctly. This is my first time going through something like this. So I just thought maybe two or three, verses. But you're right. We might need to go down to two, because everyone is, this is, I think this is going to carry on great conversations, lengthy ones too, Catherine. I agree with you.
Yeah, I seem to agree as well. And how he, puts us into action at the end of each chapter, you know, with the Du Tao Now there, and, gets us to actually use it. For me, I probably need to go through each verse, you know, a couple times, or do that exercise, and then if we kind of take notes and like we did with the last book, we had our own examples. I'm sure there's going to be plenty of examples and talk about. It's just, you know, there's 81 of these scripts, so if, you know, we're looking at going for 81 weeks on this, if that's the way we do it. But I think there's a lot of growth that we can see in that. So I'm looking forward to it. I think that's a good way to do it, is, you know, spend some time on, 1 week on each one. But we could certainly do two a week. I don't know. I'm open for whatever. So.
Well, I'll throw myself out here just because even though I've heard of Dr. Wayne Dyer, but I literally have not read anything. I don't really know much, a whole lot about him. But I agree. I think, you know, just based on what you guys are saying, that, you know, kind of like with the last book and kind of some of the things we do, we tend to, you know, let the book kind of guide us, you know, and let it bring out what we need to bring out for ourselves and then to share with everybody else. So I think that's kind of like, you know, still the guideline, you know, just kind of let it lead us and show us what we all need to bring out to share with others. So that's my little bit.
Cool. For all of you that haven't read much of Wayne Dyer, all of his books are fabulous. The Power of Intention will change your life. So I'm just putting that out there.
Yeah, I agree that, although that they're short, they're deep, and we could definitely get a lot of conversation out of one section per week, but I could see doing two too, but it may be too much. I don't know. But it's, I'm excited. Either way, it'll be good, whatever flow we do.
Awesome. Awesome. I think you're right. I think we should just let the book guide us and just kind of see where it goes, because we may get into it and read a verse, and then we all share our thoughts on what it means, and then we haven't even touched on what Wayne says. You know, I mean, who knows? Or we may go through it and everybody's sitting here going, now what do we talk about? And then, you know, of course, we can go on to the next verse and kind of go from there. So let's kind of talk about the beginning of this book then, this preface. He shares some interesting information in here. Of course, he talks about, you know, how he came about writing the book in the first place, and that, you know, of course, like I said, he got a number of different translations because he really wanted to thoroughly understand what it was saying. But let's see here. I wanted to read something specific in here about what exactly the Tao Te Ching is, and now I can't find it. Somebody else want to share what their thoughts are, and I'll look for that, look for exactly what it was I wanted to share, just so that everybody understands exactly what it is that we're studying. I think that'll be important. Unless somebody else.
I was wondering, did you want to maybe every week do a little bit of a reading of what, you know, how he explains it, or at least of the script that we're discussing? I mean, is there, you know, because I think how he, in the preface, he talks about discussing that or really immersing himself in the Tao and in that, in each verse for you know, a number of days. And, you know, I mean, it's going to be a personal experience for each one of us. So there's going to be tons of content, I think. And, you know, but it's going to be hard for people that are just listening along or following along to even follow along if we don't actually read from the book a little bit, I think. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think you're right, Jason. I think that maybe at the beginning of each of our mastermind sessions is we read the verse that we're discussing and then open it up for each of our interpretations, and then after that kind of discuss what Wayne has said in the section behind that. And then of course if any individual wants to quote something from what Wayne said, that's fine, or you know, anything along that lines. I mean, what do you guys think?
I was gonna throw this out. I know on another like mastermind that I take part on pretty regularly, they do that same similar idea, and I think it helps kind of bring everybody into the same thought process, same, you know. Plus, I think it'll help put the Tao out there to kind of start working and get our minds all kind of in that same thought process as we're reading it, and it might jump something out, you know, even right at that point, rather than just jumping into discussion. So I think, you know, that might be a very powerful way to go about it also.
Do we want to maybe designate someone each week to do something like that, to have a more integral part in the discussion than the rest? Or do we want to just kind of go with the flow?
I'm sorry, I totally wasn't listening when you said that, Dan. I was trying to find the passage that I wanted to read from this preface, and I apologize for that. Can you summarize what you just said so that I'm not completely lost? I'm sorry.
What I just said? Okay, basically what I said, I think being on another mastermind call that I'm a part of, it actually is a physical call. So it's not like this, but what they do is they do read parts of the book, certain parts, chapters or key parts, and they go over that and they kind of lead that into their mastermind discussion. And I think it helps get everybody kind of on the same page, get their minds going. Plus, if we're reading part of the Tao, it might put that into motion too. And, you know, something might really jump out and might, you know, help a breakthrough or something for somebody or, you know, something like that. And I think it can be a powerful way of getting the whole community, whoever's on and listening and joining us, as well as us, on that same level, I guess, you so to speak, to collectively and kind of see what it brings out that way.
Okay, so like after introductions, do you want to maybe go right, rather than going into what we experienced from it, rather go right into the reading of it? And then, so that it gives everyone a foundation if they're just tuning in to what we're talking about, and then go into our experiences with the activity that he suggests, possibly.
This actually brings up a really great point. Is you know, when we first started the Saturday Morning Mastermind, that's kind of exactly what we did. We read a section of the book. Or even, yeah, I think that at the time we were studying the psycho-cybernetics and we were reading a section and then we would discuss it. So we'd spend like 20 or so minutes reading the first part of or whatever section we were on. And then the last half of the call, we'd spend discussing it. And then we kind of got away from that a little bit and started doing more of the discussion because it seemed like we were having a lot more to say than what we could squeeze into 30 minutes. So it's kind of been going back and forth with, you know, sharing in the pre-mastermind discussion on the page and or on, you know, in the community, and, you know, sharing the discussion and on our live broadcast and reading parts and that sort of thing. So I'm completely open to whatever we decide to do. And I'm kind of, so I've been thinking a little bit about that whole side of reading more of it so that whoever does tune in, they know what we're talking about without having to pick the book up. So I think that might be a good way, a good idea to go back to that. I mean, what does everybody else think? Catherine, I mean, you and Sandy were both here at the beginning when we were doing it the other way. What are your thoughts on it?
I think that'll work perfectly for this one, you know, reading the verse. I that's perfect, yeah. It worked well before, too. It just, you know, we just kind of switched the way we were doing it because of the books we were on. But for this particular book, I think that's a perfect strategy. And each of us, you know, maybe writing a paragraph or whatever we feel compelled to write, you know, explaining how we interpreted it and sharing it there on the website so that we get all of the different interpretations there in one place where we can easily look at them and combine them together.
I was just reading some of the comments on the page, and Karen Loloff says, and I'm just reading exactly what she says, the last several comments and beginning with Samantha answering Julia's question about time frame really have made me wish there was a transcribing ability better than YouTube's bottom level associated with these hangouts. There's meat to everyone's thoughts that would be nice to be able to chew on later. And I think you just hit a nice, head on the nail about, you know, sharing what we get out of it on the actual site too. I think that's another powerful way of sharing, getting it out there with everybody.
Yeah, Karen, are you talking, you're talking about actual transcription of the whole video, aren't you? And I've actually, I've looked into that a little bit about having someone do that for us, and it's a little bit more than what we have in our financial budget to get that done, but I am open to anybody who would like to volunteer to do transcription for the videos, because that would be often awesome. Or even just summaries, you know, that would be great too, and those are some of the things that we're looking for people to help us out with until we can start generating some more revenue for the community, which that'll happen in time. But right now we're all working off of volunteers and donations, guys. So anything you want to send our way, there is a donation page and a contributor page on our website where you can find out more about what we're looking for people. But that's an awesome, I would love to have somebody transcribe the videos. That'd be sweet. Anybody else have
any? I was just going to say that I'm okay with whatever decisions we make, because as I mentioned, this is all brand new to me. So I'm sure that as we go along, ideas will come up and I will share it with the group. But however anyone wants to do it, I'm okay with that. Okay.
Awesome. Okay, so let's kind of dig into this. We've still got a half an hour left on our hangout. So let me just read this beginning portion here, because Wayne talks a little bit about what the Tao Te Ching is. And so I'll just dig in. So he says, change your thoughts, change your life is the end product of my year-long journey of research, contemplation, and application of the Tao Te Ching, a book of wisdom that's been translated more than any volume in the world, with the exception of the Bible. Many scholars consider this Chinese classic the ultimate disclosure on nature of existence, and it continues to be a valuable resource for achieving a way of life that guarantees integrity, joy, peace, and balance. I recently read about someone who overcame a life-threatening addiction behaviors by reading and rereading the 81 verses of this ancient text. Just imagine, in fewer than 100 short passages, it describes a way of living that's balanced, moral, and spiritual, and that works for all facets of life on earth. Let's see. Oh, legend tells us that Tao Te Ching was authored by Lao Tzu. I hope I'm pronouncing that one right. A prophet who was also the keeper of imperial archives at the ancient capital of Laoyang. Seeing the continual decay during a period of warring states, Lao Tzu decided to ride westward into the desert at the Haku Pass, a gate named Yin Hishi. Knowing of Lao Tzu's reputation for being a man of wisdom, begged him to record the essence of his teaching. Thus, the Tao Te Ching was born out of 5,000 Chinese characters. Okay, so, and then he just kind of talks about the historical writing of the definitive historical record of its writing. But what do you guys think about this as far as he kind of talks about it being the, let's see, let me go back to what it says. Okay, being a valuable resource for achieving a way of life that guarantees integrity, joy, peace, and balance. I thought that was really interesting, and one of the reasons that I'm kind of drawn to this, and it's similar, I think, in a lot of ways to many other spiritual writings, you know, like the Bible and you know, other ones like that, because it shares just way of living. So I'm interested to see how it does compare to like the Bible. I mean, I've read the Bible, but I haven't read many other spiritual scriptures. What have you guys read, other than, you know, obviously we're getting started on this.
Go ahead, Jason.
I was just saying, you know, this is going to be kind of challenging, because it's hard to describe, you know, and as like they say in the book, it's a mystery in and of itself. Even the writing of it is a mystery, you know, and how it actually came about, and then the mystery itself of the Tao, you know, but it seems to be, and if I were to compare it to the Bible, so far what I read, it doesn't seem to be very religious. It's more about, so far, it's more about like acceptance and experiencing that duality of, you know, both sides of things, and accepting it at the same time, and feeling the power of that, and the power of creation through allowing rather than forcing something, you know. And sometimes I've experienced that through life, where it seems like, you know, you're kind of in the groove and in the flow, and it's like you might hit all those green lights going to work, and everything seems to just be clicking, and it's like you're not really even trying to make it manifest, but it's just sort of happening for you and opening up for you. And I think this sort of, at least the first verse seemed to talk about that, and also, you know, like it says, stretch your mind a little bit. So what do you guys think?
I'm sorry. Go ahead. No, you go ahead. I'll wait. Okay. Go ahead.
Okay, honey. Thank you.
Did she freeze up, or is it just me?
Yeah, she froze. She froze.
Okay. Well, go ahead, Julia, and then if she'll pop back up here. And
okay. I just wanted to say that when I was reading the preface and the first verse of the book, it was actually, I didn't think of anything as far as specifically the Bible. When I was reading it, I wasn't visualizing the Bible, but there were some of the things that he did mention was mentioned in the Bible. So immediately I thought of, oh, this is in the Bible, because a lot of who I am, you know, does come from the Bible, my happiness, everything. And I, you know, I study the gospel and so forth. And so when I was reading this, it took me back to what some of the things that are mentioned in the Bible, which made me very stay path. And so once again, I do look forward to continuing on to this, because I feel like it will, along with everything that I've learned, it's just going to expand what I know and bring me closer to where I need to be. So this book is going to be very personal for me. And that's all I wanted to say. I think being away for like 2 weeks is kind of like got me like, I'm kind of like dazed a little bit. I got to get used to talking back on the Hangout.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Did she get back? Catherine, did you make it?
No, she has her profile picture.
Okay. Anybody else want to jump out? I want to read what BG mentioned in the pre-discussion, but not if you guys are, if you have a thought that you're ready to jump out with. No. Okay. Let me scroll down to what she wrote. I can find it. Where is it? Okay. All right. So she says, I just read the preface. I'm looking forward to this. One comment which I really love is staying quiet, enjoy, let others think you are dumb while you enjoy. And she says, it makes me think of Jesus in the Bible. He was accused and remained quiet. How hard that is for many of us. It's at those times, most of us want to lash out and say, no, I'm not dumb. I'm this, I'm that. But if you are secure enough to know who you are and what you are attached to and remain silent through the accusations and insults of others, then you really believe in yourself and who you are attached to. For if you know who you are, then it doesn't really matter what others think you are. Although I do think it's nice to be well thought of. LOL. That's awesome. I wanted to kind of talk about that. That's a profound statement right there, right? You know, how many times have you had somebody say something about you that you completely didn't like? You didn't appreciate them saying whatever it was, and you wanted to kind of stand up for yourself or argue with them or any number of things and say, no, I'm not that, you know, whatever. I know my husband has had a lot of situations where he's got all these guys that he works with and they're always out to get each other. And so they'll say mean things and start rumors about each other for no good reason. And I'm like, do you believe that about you? Because if you do, then yeah, you got a problem. But if you don't, then you don't have anything to worry about. So what if so-and-so said whatever he said about you? It doesn't matter, right? What do you guys think, you know, if about what she said? Just go from there.
Yeah, it sort of reminded me of this part that I underlined in the book, and how, you know, Lao Tzu uses irony and paradox to look at life. And so, you know, our normal reactions to something like that, like somebody saying something about us, we immediately want to, you know, lash back out. A lot of the times is our initial reaction, but, you know, letting go and, you know, being humble, like in this phrase he says, if you think that Wayne Dyer saying, if you think that being forceful is the appropriate response, Lao Tzu urges you to see the value in being humble. If action seems called for, he asks you to consider non-action. If you feel that grasping will help you acquire what you need or want, he counsels you to let go and be patient. And, you know, as I read that too, it's, you know, things are going a little cuckoo in our world right now. So it's also very timely that we're reading this book, because it can help us to maybe see what's going on in the world or react to what's going on in the world in a different way than how a lot of people are reacting. That's just creating more tension. How can we sort of let go through the chaos going on? And so I think this book will really be helpful during the times we're going through on the planet here too. So. And thanks for sharing that, BG. It's a it's a good insight. Thanks for sharing.
I was going to say, I don't know if I've ever really seen anybody or if I've done it, but I can imagine the power in somebody just, you know, being so sure of themselves and being strong in themselves that they don't really need to defend themselves. And that speaks sometimes louder than words, kind of like the old saying, in a weird analogy, you know, to, you know, speak softly but carry a big stick, but, you know, kind of in reverse, where in this case, you know, you're just kind of letting your actions or yourself or, you know, who you are defend you rather than lashing out and trying to attack the other person. And I think there's this real power and strength there when somebody can do that, because then it really shows that you are in a lot more control of how you respond to things, and you don't just knee-jerk type, you know, things like a lot of people tend to do.
I agree with you there, Dan. I'm also thinking that, you know, sometimes our, you know, intentional inaction comes across to people in another way, and they get, you know, they have their own ideas as to why, you know, what that means. And then those, you know, not that I really, like, if that happens to me, I'm not really too worried about what they think, except if they keep their thoughts quiet and then they act on them, you know, thinking, okay, so, like, well, Dan isn't sticking up for himself, so he's not the type of person I want on my team. But I'm not going to address that with Dan and tell Dan that that's why I don't want him on my team. I'm just not going to have him on my team, and, you know, we're not going to hire him, or are going to give the job to someone else. And so we don't even know what we might be losing out on if we don't at least stand up for ourselves in some way, shape, or form. So I do agree in a sense with that this philosophy, but I also see there's, you know, some unintentional results that could occur.
Yes, I agree with you, Jason. I agree with you. I think the ego, I can only, you know, my ego can at times get in the way, and it has multiple times in the past. And then as I continue on this journey of self-discovery, I do react differently to certain situations or events that might not be very pleasing to me. So I do feel, you know, if something is said or done, how we go about it is going to make the difference, because in the end, I have to live with what I said or what I did, and I try really hard not to live with any type of regret. So if I was defending myself, if I felt that I needed to defend myself, my approach will be much different than what it would have been years ago. I think, you know, it's not okay for someone to out say however they feel about you, something negative or so forth, because we do know, or I know who I am. And I will say, you know, I appreciate your opinion, you know, and I, you know, would appreciate it that you, you know, you keep it to yourself. Something to those terms where I am not taking myself out of my current humbleness, but then again, letting the other person know, I don't appreciate what you did, and, you know, cut it out in some sort of way. But I don't think it's okay that we just let it happen, because, and maybe, like I said, this is all a learning process for me, but, you know, we all have feelings, and, you know, it does have an effect on us in some way. So I right now at this point, it's not okay for someone to insult me or my character or how far I've come and not say anything about it. I don't think that's okay with me, but once again, it's how I approach the situation that will make a big difference. And I think I have a right to stand up for myself. I do. I don't think I will be. It depends on what's said, you know, but I won't be quiet about it. Maybe I will. Who knows? At the end of the book, I'll be like, okay, you know, but I just think that, you know, we have feelings, and we, you know, we need to express it in order to have some type of release or closure. But once again, how we go about it is my process of learning.
I think, sorry guys, I got knocked out. My computer is having challenges. But I followed a message from Spirit the other day and checked Craigslist on a whim and got a really excellent computer, $1,200 computer for like $300. So I just had to order a couple of parts for it, and I'm waiting for that to come in, but then I won't be getting kicked off these things anymore, which is awesome. So what I started to say before I left was that I have read different spiritual texts, and I can't remember like all the names of all of them, but and not like every word and every one. As a kid, I kind of got sent out to every church bus that went down the road, and I got to experience different religions. And as an adult, I, you know, have experienced different spiritual beliefs or whatever. And there's a common thread, you know, amongst all of them. They all have their different mysteries, I guess, but there's definitely common threads there. The thing about this book, I think, I haven't read this one yet, so, but where I think this is going to take us, and I have read a little bit of I don't know how to say it, Tao Te Ching, or however you say it. You know, our suffering comes from our resistance to things, regardless of what the situation is, you know, whether it's pain, you know, or frustration, or whatever it is, it's our resistance to it that causes our suffering. And when people say things, you know, they state their belief about whatever, and if that offends us, I guess, you know, very simplistically, what it's saying is, rather than react to them, actually go inside and recognize, you know, if like something they said pisses you off, you need to ask yourself, why is that pissing me off, instead of responding to them in a pissed off way. You know, you just have to ask why, you know, what is it in me that's being triggered right now that's causing me to feel this emotion? Because other people, you know, you can't control what other people think or what other people do or anything. Half the time we can't even control ourselves, much less somebody else. So if something that somebody does to you, and I've and not even does to you, but something, because people don't do things to you, you kind of let them do things to you, you know what I mean? So, but I've had some situations recently that have really pushed my limits in this area, as far as, you know, trying to stay out of resistance. And it's super hard. It's like really, really hard and heartbreaking sometimes. But, you know, those heartbreaking moments are when I really have to think, okay, what still needs to be healed within me? Why do these things trigger me like this? Why does this cause me so much emotional pain? What is it about myself, you know, that I don't feel like I'm good enough, or I don't feel whatever it is I'm feeling in that moment, you know, and work with that, you know, and heal yourself. And then you'll find that they don't trigger you, and you don't have to stand up for yourself anymore, kind of thing, you know, because you're not in resistance to what they're saying. So, but like I said, much easier than done, especially when you're in a situation. I mean, our natural instinct, we get triggered, we get into fear, we get into hurt, you know, and just like an animal that's cornered, you know, they just want to lash out because, and it's really quite simple, because we're energetic beings, and on an energetic scale, if you look at the frequencies of the different emotions, you know, sorrow and sadness is way, way, way down, and shame way, way, way down on that frequency scale, as far as what can be measured electronically. I'm not talking woo-woo stuff here. And so when we move from sorrow to anger, it's actually an that's higher. Anger is higher on the frequency scale than sorrow is. So it's actually sort of a survival mechanism almost, you know, to move up into that anger to get us out of that sorrow, because it actually raises our vibration a little bit. You can, if you want to look at it through the medical text, you can look at Kubler-Ross. She has like a grief scale and stuff, and there's very specific levels that we move through as we're processing some of these thoughts. I'll shut up now. Bye.
Oh, I wanted to remind everybody there. Well, okay. In where did I read this? I was reading Wayne Dyer's book, I Can See Clearly Now, which is a memoir, and of his life and whatnot. He was talking about this time when he was in elementary school. And there was kids that are acting out in his classroom, and the teacher said, "You are bad kids," or something to that effect. And it was really hurting the feelings of the children, right? And what Wayne did is he went to his friend and he says, "If the teacher told you you were a tree, would you be upset about that? Would that hurt your feelings?" And she's like, "Well, of course not, because I'm not a tree. Duh, right? So why would it hurt my feelings?" And so when we come back around and we say, okay, this person out here, this random person, whoever it is, whether it's your sister or whether it is your cousin or whether it's your coworker or whoever it is, says something bad about you that you know inside yourself is not true, you wouldn't be hurt by it if you kind of look at it as if they're just saying you're a tree. And you're like, "Well, no, I'm not." You're crazy, right? You think you don't necessarily have to defend yourself, because you know on an ultimate, without a doubt level that that's not true, and what they're saying is like Looney Tunes. You know what I'm saying? I mean, does that make sense, guys? I mean, that's kind of how I look at it. And Catherine, you were just saying something. And the part about it kind of triggering something inside of you. So if someone says something to you and it bugs you, it irritates you, it makes you angry, it whatever it is, it's not because of what they said, it's because of what you believe about yourself. Maybe you resonate with whatever it is that they're saying on some level, and you don't like it. You don't like the idea of possibly being whatever it is that that person says that you are. So if you've got somebody going around telling people that you're lazy, and you are working so hard not to be lazy, but yet on some level you're still working on it, and that, you know, that hurts your feeling that somebody's still out there thinking it, then you know, okay, it's me. I'm the one that's upset. It doesn't have anything to do with them. Because what if that person was on the other side of the world? You didn't have anything to do with them. You never saw them. You never anything. And they were jumping up and down and they were saying, "Samantha is an asshole. Samantha is a dumbass. Samantha is a da 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 da." I would never hear it. I would never see it. I would never experience it. And so therefore it would not hurt me in any way, shape or form. They could say the worst thing in the universe about me and it wouldn't affect me because it is outside my realm of experience. Right. And so if we look at people at what they say, and we remember that technically they're outside of our realm of experience, if we keep them outside of that, and that anything that they do that you know kind of triggers something in us, that means that we are resonating with it somehow and going, that's something else I need to work on, because it's still pissing me off. You know, I don't know. What do you guys think?
Well, Samantha, I'm over here laughing because I'm saying to myself, well, if I get into, you know, if someone says something, I'm going to say, "Did she just call me a tree?" And just, you know, that's going to be my thing. When someone said something, I'm going to say, "She just called me a tree," because I know I'm not a tree. So it's not going to affect me. I really like that a lot. I don't get into a lot of situations with, you know, anyone, but just in case it does, I think that's interesting. I'll just flip it around and say, "She just called me a tree." And I like Catherine, when you mentioned that when someone says something that it's negative and we respond, we are resisting what is really being said, and we're resisting of having to look really internally within ourselves. Because in the past, I've always said, why would she say something like that? Or why would he say something like that? And I'm so focused on why they would say something like that and trying to analyze the whole statement when I really need to look at myself and find out, why am I reacting this way? Or why am I trying to figure this person out? And so I really like that. I learned a lot from just this one thing, you know, resistance. And did she call me a tree? I love you guys. I think you guys are so great. Thank you. I learned a lot.
Yeah, I'm kind of with Julia right now, because I've been dealing with some things, with some work things, and I've been in that really negative mode about some things, and it's affected me. And it's from, again, perceptions or thoughts or how I perceive, you know. And but this, I love this concept. Did they just call me a tree? It's like, well, no, I'm not a tree. So is that really who I am? And now as I'm looking at it at work, I'm going to have until I can get free and break out of that. And, you know, I'm doing what I'm wanting to do full time. It's going to help change that. And it might take some of my own resistance that I've been feeling within myself at work, about changes and things going on, that I'm going to be using that. He just called me a tree a lot, and trying to write that down somewhere so I can flip to it and read it. So it helps me stay in that vein, because that's powerful what you were sharing, Samantha, that, you know, we all tend to forget that a lot of times what people say is comes from perceptions or their own views. And once again, going back to internal things about themselves that they might not like, so they're projecting it onto us, and it has no real value, no real, you know, effect. And we let it have that effect, and then I get to resisting, and I get to be negative, and then it, you know, just spirals from there even. So yeah, very powerful the last couple of minutes. I like that. Yeah, I appreciate it, both what all of you have just said. It's going to be helpful.
Well, and if you are really honest with yourself, it's not what they say that hurts your feelings. It's that voice, that little voice that comes out inside your head that starts saying shit like, I'm not enough, or, you know, whatever it is you're dealing with at the time. It's what we say to ourselves. And I've said this before on past hangouts, but when you're feeling that strong emotion like that, take a moment and just remind yourself that whatever you're thinking isn't true. And that's why it's causing all of that emotion. You know, if you're telling yourself, I'm not enough or whatever, you know, that's not true, right? So that's that heavy emotion is like this huge red flag waving to us, saying you're lying to yourself, or, you know, you're believing shit that isn't true. Sorry for all the cuss words today. You're believing stuff that isn't true, you know, and that's why you're feeling that emotion. And realize, just like the name in this book, you can change those emotions by changing your thoughts, because it's your thoughts about whatever it is that's causing that to, you know, it's thoughts that aren't true that are causing the emotion. So if you change your thoughts, sorry, I got a train and a phone and everything going on here. if you change your thoughts, you know, and you can change your thoughts about these things. I'm going to hush because this train, but we'll get to that next week, maybe.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's what this is all about, changing our thoughts and changing our lives. And, you know, and you know, it seems to me it's relative. It's relative to the way we're, you know, the angle at which we're looking at things and our perception, like, you know, Dan and Julia and everyone's been pointing out. And they even talk about, you know, labeling in this, and that the, I think you're saying that the Tao is the way, and that the mystery, the tea is the color, coloring, or the yeah, just like the, I don't know, I guess characterization and the way we kind of the way we perceive things and changing that. But he talks about, you know, labels of, and I think it's in the next verse, but talks about how, you know, even a tree, I mean, that's just what we call it. That's not what it is. You know, I've always thought of, like, you know, how, like, if there was life on other planets that we knew about, I wonder what they would call a tree, you know, what would their word be for it? It wouldn't mean that that's what it actually is, but it's just what, it's a label, it's a way of communicating what we are, you know, what we mean. It doesn't actually mean that that's what it was. And, you know, so if someone calls you a tree and you're in class, you know, you think, well, you're just, you know, that's weird. But if you're in a drama class and they say, hey, you're a tree, and then you're going to act like a tree, because that's in, you know, that's your going to be your perception. That's the relative to where you are and what you're doing. You know, if someone calls you bad in a class, then if you want to think of it differently, you could make that an acronym for something else, you know, like, oh, yeah, you're right, I'm bad, I'm better at doing things, you know, or something like that. And you can just change it in your mind and decide to have a different viewpoint about it, you know. So yeah, you know, this really is going to be interesting, and I'm you know, stretching my mind around this, and I think we're all going to get a lot out of it. So I really appreciate you all your comments, and it's great to see you all again and be here. So thank you.
Imagine what the world would be like if everybody stopped feeling or stopped being offended by what everyone else said, you know. And because if that were to happen, then the people who are saying things would eventually have no reason to say them, right? Because they wouldn't be affecting you. And so then they might go, they might start thinking, well, maybe if someone said something about me, it's not that big a deal, it's no big thing. And the world would change instantly. Well, not instantly, obviously, but, you know, it would just be a completely different world. I don't know. It's kind of deep. But it was interesting, Jason, where you're talking about, you know, the naming of things. And of course, here in this little section, it talks about her, Lao Tzu calls it the world of 10,000 things. And I think we'll talk more about that in the next chapter. But he's talking about how it says the Tao, or the Tao, excuse me, it's pronounced Tao. We looked that up. The Tao never begins or ends, does nothing, and yet animates everything in the world of form and boundaries, which is called the world of the 10,000 things. And so, just like what Jason was talking about, is when we name something, that is when we define it in the world of the 10,000 things. So, I don't know. This is going to be an interesting book. And anybody want to add anything before we wrap up for today? Should we read the first verse to get everybody thinking about it for next week? What do you think? Yeah? Who wants to read it?
I can read it.
Steady.
Excuse me. Okay, first verse. The Tao that can be told is not the eternal Tao. The name that can be named is not the eternal name. The Tao is both named and nameless. As nameless, it is the origin of all things. As named, it is the mother of 10,000 things. Ever desireless, one can see the mystery. Ever desiring, one sees only the manifestations. And the mystery itself is the doorway to all understanding.
Awesome. Thank you, Sandy. So there's something to think about, guys. And in here, I just want to read this one little part here that Wayne suggests. He says, so for maximum enjoyment and benefit, make reading this book a personal journey. First, peruse one of the passages of the Tao Te Ching and the essay that follows it. Next, spend some time applying it. changing the way you've been conditioned to think, and letting yourself open up to a new way of conceptualizing these ideas. Finally, individualize the verse by writing, recording, drawing, or expressing yourself in whatever way you feel called to. And I think that's probably a good idea, is that we all, you know, we read this, reread the verse, reread the set, the chapter, and then see what comes to us throughout the week. I know sometimes we end up waiting till the last minute to read the chapter and then talk about it on the Saturday Mastermind, but I think we should do it the other way around, is we should read it right away after we have our mastermind session, and then let it stew a little bit. And if you feel compelled to write something about what you think the meaning is, you can share it on the Saturday Morning Mastermind page in the comments. If you feel like making a video and sharing your thoughts on it, then you can post a link to the video in the comments. Whatever you guys feel like doing. And what I think that I will do is that as we get some comments that are, you know, insightful, kind of like what BG wrote in the comments this week, is that I can share those as well as my own thoughts or anyone else's thoughts, and we can create a whole separate blog post that can relate to the Saturday Morning Mastermind. And just that way we can, I think that when we share our insights, is that more and more people are able to get more out of it. And so that's what I'm going to recommend, is that read it, think about it a little bit right after our mastermind, and let it stew, and then sometime during the week write something about it and share it on the page. So with that, guys, have an awesome, amazing, and wonderful weekend. I look forward to having this discussion again next week on the first verse, and then so we'll talk about that next week, and then the week after that we're actually going to have our free the abundance reboot that Catherine's going to do for us. So we'll do that right before Christmas, then we'll take off Christmas weekend, and then we'll meet back here again for the Saturday after New Year. So just to kind of give you a heads up on schedule, we'll let you know about all that. And if you haven't already, go ahead and jump on our mailing list. I'll make sure that there's a link. Actually, if you're on our website, just kind of look over there on the sidebar, and you'll see a box that'll tell you you can get on our mailing list, and go ahead and do that. Otherwise, please like the video, share it, you know, add to the conversation, follow us on YouTube, Facebook, or we're not on Facebook yet. We will be eventually. Anyway, that's it for now. Have a great day, and we'll see you next week. Bye.